With our today's first technical session, now I would like to introduce CA Kulraj Aspanani ji. Sir, Kulraj ji holds experience of more than 13 years in the field of indirect taxation. Over the years, Kulraj ji has advised and represented clients of diverse sectors on indirect tax issues, structuring areas and planning opportunities. Kulraj, sir, area of expertise includes law relating to GST, excise duty, service tax, VAT, custom duty, and foreign trade policy. Kulraj ji is a regular speaker at various industry and forums, associations, and industry workshops. Kulraj ji is also a member of ICAI and he also holds a bachelor's degree in commerce and law. He has worked with Nirthya Tax Associates, BMR and Associates LLP, and economic law practice in this indirect tax practice. Right now, he is associated as principal with Dhruva Advisors, and we would like to welcome him for the first time on our platform. Welcome, Kulraj ji, over to you to begin with the session on a very interesting topic.
Thank you, Shubham. Is my voice audible, Shubham?
Yes, sir, loud and clear, sir.
Perfect. And at the outset, I congratulate everyone for the CA Day, and I also congratulate everyone for this fourth year journey of GST, which has been so exciting. I thank WebTIL, CGPI, and AFPP for organizing this extremely useful webinar, a training session. I'll just take word from what Atulji said and take it forward. The agenda that I've been given today is to kind of discuss the key Supreme Court rulings that have been there in GST regime. I'll put forth a presentation to that. Just let me know, Shubham, when it is visible. Is it there, Shubham?
Clearly visible, sir. Clearly.
Perfect. Thank you. So in next or 20-25 minutes, we'll be discussing what are the key rulings that have been there in Supreme Court under the GST regime. So before getting into the ruling, the first thing that we kind of will be discussing is that from a litigation perspective, from a ruling, Supreme Court ruling perspective, from a dispute perspective, goods and service tax has not been a real good and simple tax. GST has seen a fair amount of litigations with several cases traveling to the Supreme Court level. And the reasons for these litigations are many. The initial reasons were technical glitches in the system, which resulted into all the Tran 1 notifications, Tran 1 notices, etc., wherein the SSCs went to the High Court level, sought relief, the matters went before the Supreme Court and is pending up there. Besides that, the legal lacuna is always there. The government has been making so many amendments. Some of the amendments have been made retrospectively to curtail the benefits and so on. So all this kind of give rise to litigations. In last 1.5 years in the COVID time, that's not been there, but department has been pretty active, pretty aggressive. What has been the most surprising thing in the GST is the involvement of DGGI in all the GST related matters. Even though to notices of 2A, 3B, the DGGI is highly involved, leading to SSCs approaching the high courts and stuff like that for seeking relief. So all in all, GST, as was envisaged to be a real simplicity takeaway, has not been so under the years to come. And from a Supreme Court, there have been several litigation. There are several matters still pending, specifically of Tran 1 inverted duty structure, liability on ocean freight, and arrest and bail provision of GST. There are several litigations that are still there at Apex Court level. However, the Apex Court has had some key rulings passed on also in over the past 5 years. What we will be debating is that we will be highlighting some of these key rulings. We'll be seeing how Supreme Court has dwelled upon each of such different ruling and what are the results into this. But as has been said, and I will kind of repeat the words, that layers of retrospection, judicial pronouncement and amendments, these are the key to make a legislative policy a successful one, a suitable one. So what we only perceive is that with all these litigations happening, with all these rulings of Apex Court, High Court, we would see a good and simple tax coming into future. That was the aspiration of all of you and me also here. With those remarks, we'll get into the judgments. The first ruling that we will be discussing is the Supreme Court ruling is Commission of Commercial Taxes versus Ramco Simmons. So one of the issues that has been there in GST is procurement of goods which are not subject to GST, petroleum products, your natural gas, etc., under the cover of a statutory form C and subject to a CST of 2%. The SSEs have gone into the High Court seeking benefit, seeking direction specific to it. And several High Courts have given direction that the benefits be given and all these goods which are not subject to GST be allowed to be received by the taxpayer under cover of Form C at 2%. The intent being because CST becomes a cost in the system, so a higher out of CST would increase the higher procurement cost and 2% CST or a C-form CST would reduce to the cost. While the High Court granted benefits, the department went into the SLP against the order before Supreme Court. What Supreme Court held was very interesting. Supreme Court held that under the CST law, there is a mandatory requirement to obtain a registration under Section 7 of the CST Act 1956. It says that it is not the mandatory condition of a seller of goods to be registered under GST. Even if a person is buying the goods which are under the levy of CST, can also take a registration. Supreme Court also held that the on the purchase of goods, even they were used for manufacturing of goods which are not subject to a GST, still the benefit of C-form should be granted. And Supreme Court made a reliance to Punjab and Haryana High Court in case of Carpo Power, which was later affirmed by Supreme Court, saying that all such goods can be procured under a cover of C-form. So therefore, Supreme Court gave a very interesting ruling to such an extent, wherein it said that all the goods which are procured on interstate basis, your diesel, petrol, natural gas, which are used for manufacturing, can be purchased under the GST law as well, under the cover of a C-form. What has been a natural consequence to these kind of rulings is that the CST law was amended, and the CST law was so changed that the goods to be procured under C-form could only be procured if these goods are used for manufacturing the goods which are not subject to a GST. So therefore, the entire benefit was taken away while the Finance Act 2021. The amendment seems to have a retrospective implication, but in our view, wherever the SSEs have stocked in goods which are subsequently used for manufacturing process, those goods are there which wherein the benefit of C-form can be taken. So yes, a very important ruling from Supreme Court from a GST perspective, granting benefit to the SSE. However, the government has taken away a benefit by an amendment in the law itself. The next ruling which we will be discussing is a very, very important ruling. This is in the case of Westinghouse SAPSI Farmers Limited versus CC Calcutta. The ruling involved a classification, and classification, as Atulji mentioned, is an important thing under the GST regime. In this case, the petitioner was manufacturing relays, and relays were used as a railway signaling equipment. Petitioner mentioned that the goods are classified as parts of railways because these are used exclusively for railways as a railway signaling equipment. Department, however, maintained a view that these are electric equipment and classified under Chapter 85. And therefore, the classification should be under Chapter 85. And surprisingly, it so happened that 85 was subject to a higher rate of duty than 86. So the department was to protecting his interest in levy of taxation and excise duty specifically. A lot of reliance was given to two specific chapter notes of Chapter 17, which held that and which were providing a different situation. Chapter notes said that the expression part and accessories do not apply to the article whether identifiable for goods for this section or not. So it said that electric machinery or equipment of Chapter 85 shall not be covered as part of accessory of a specific good, even if they are specifically identifiable as part of that good. Note 3, however, contrary to that, held that we need to give reliance to the sole user test. We need to give reliance to the suitability test. So if a product is suitable for use with a particular good, then it shall be classified along with a particular good only. So there were debates around classification under these Note 2 and Note 3. Supreme Court held that the sole or principal use test is the main test for classification. So relays which are used as railway signaling equipment will get classified as part of railways and it should be classified under Chapter 86 only. While the Supreme Court held that, the Note 2 was rendered completely redundant. So Note 2, which specifically provided for exclusion, was not considered, and a suitability or principal use text was given reliance. The Supreme Court in this ruling very unfortunately has kind of unsettled a settled position in law, which has been dealt by Supreme Court in various previous judgments, wherein it gave reliance to note 2 rather than note 3, wherein the principle of sole use or suitability test was not relied to. This ruling shall have a specific ramifications for the automobile industry, particularly where the parts are classified under 18%, while the automotive get classified under 28%. The department in all such cases can raise a dispute that parts are specifically used for automobile, so they should be covered as part of automobile and should be subject to a rate of 28% GST. We see this ruling to have a extreme negative implications in the years to come, wherein department would certainly debate all these things, wherein there's a debate upon classification of part of a particular good, and that particular goods can get classified at a higher rate of tax. The next ruling which we will be talking has a practical relevance to it and would be relevant to a lot of people out here. You see in a real business situation, a lot of disputes do arise because of the goods being seized, because of improper documentation, e-way bill not in accordance with the regulation, the e-way bill invoicing do mismatch and stuff like that. In these situations, the petitioner were approaching the high courts directly seeking a relief. A lot of high courts, including Allahabad High Court, granted interim relief to the petitioner, and they said that the goods be released on furnishing only of indemnity bond without payment of any security or a bank guarantee. The matter ultimately went to Supreme Court. The state of UP went into Supreme Court against those decisions of High Court. The High Court gave a very interesting ruling in decision. High Court said that 67 of the CGST Act provide for a complete code of release of goods which have been detained, which have been caught because of infractions. The Supreme Court said that such goods can be released only as per the GST Act, which requires furnishing of a bond or a security or a bank guarantee to the extent of tax, interest or penalty amount. And it held that the action of High Court in granting the interim relief is incorrect. So very important ruling by Supreme Court, wherein the High Court's action of granting interim relief was granted redundant. The ruling shall have a huge amount of practical implications because in cases where the goods are seized without proper application of law would be disputed. The decision is likely to be followed by various high courts wherein this requirement will be sought. As a consequence, the taxpayer is required to take a call whether they need to approach a high court or authority, because in both of the cases, there is a requirement of furnishing of bank guarantee or a security. And indemnity bond is not something that is being considered, and interim relief is not granted based on the interim bond. So very, very important ruling from a practical perspective. Shubham, I'm sorry. Yeah, there were some marks that were coming. Okay.
Yes, sir. I'll just correct that, sir. Just one.
Yeah. I think that has been corrected, Shubham. We can go forward. Next ruling which we'll be discussing is a very recent ruling of Supreme Court in case of P.V. Ramana Reddy. Ruling again is extremely, extremely important from the perspective wherein the petitioners were approaching High Court from seeking an anticipatory bail from arrest and so on, specifically in cases where there have been fraud, suppression, etc. So in these cases, a lot of petitioners went to Telangana High Court seeking a specific writ not to arrest them, and the summon that were issued for their arrest was challenged, and it was contended that revenue was contending that all these petitioners had done circular trading. They had claimed excess ITC on the fake invoicing and there's a significant loss. The High Court, very interesting, gave an observation that Section 69 of the GST Act says that the commissioner has to have a reason to believe. So if the reasons to believe are there in the file record, then and no order needs to be passed, those orders of simple arrest can be invoked. What was specifically challenged was that the arrest can be made only after completion of assessment and not prior thereto. So only after determination of a tax liability. The High Court, on the contrary, held that no, the arrest can be made before completion of assessment, before determination of a liability. As soon as the commissioner has a reasons to believe that the applicant or the petitioner have done fraud suppression and the fraud suppression value exceeds the threshold limit under the GST law, arrest can be made. There was reliance to provisions of CRPC, which said that in a proceedings wherein the petitioner or the one who is challenged is supporting in the proceedings, helping out, then arrest cannot be made. So the High Court very categorically said that no, this is not the case. The arrest can be made, and resort to provision of CRPC cannot be done. However, an important pronouncement that was given in the ruling was that in all such cases wherein these are the cases of fraud, suppression, and you can approach, the writ petitions can be filed before the High Court, and writ petitions will be considered as an anticipatory bail only. In this very case, however, the anticipatory bail was denied. But yes, the very important ruling that anticipatory bail can be sought before filing a writ petition before the High Court. The Supreme Court in this case upheld the High Court decision and affirmed the view. So therefore, in all the cases where summons have been issued, while an SSC can approach a High Court seeking an anticipatory bail, it shall be on High Court to grant a bail or not. It will not be a reasonable presumption that in all cases the bail would be granted. In our view,
request you to kindly wind up another 2 to 5 minutes, sir.
Surely, Shubham. In our view, the power to arrest has been a very, very burning issue under GST. Telangana High Court has ruled up something, and which has been followed by the Supreme Court. What has been more important is that the pre-arrest bail was granted in Bombay High Court in Sapna Jain versus Union of India. The matter is finally going to be settled by larger bench. So this entire issue of anticipatory bail is going to be settled by a Supreme Court decision. Till that time, the Supreme Court decision in POI Ramana Reddy is going to be followed by High Court in granting anticipatory bail. So wherever the issue is of high revenue stake, the benefit may not be available for anticipatory bail. That is what the precedent could be. Last ruling, and we'll very, very quickly wind it up, is the challenge before Supreme Court whether actionable claims can be covered as a part of goods or not. The Parliament, the challenge was whether lotteries, which were actionable claim, can be regarded as good and subject to GST. The challenge was before Supreme Court. Supreme Court said that yes, Parliament has the exclusive power and very wide power under Article 246A of the Constitution to regard anything as goods or not. And goods have been given a wide and an inclusive definition under the Constitution. So therefore, Parliament has all those powers. What Supreme Court also held and what was contended by the petitioner is that price money should be excluded, and the value, if you are charging GST on the lottery, then it should be taxed at a notional value. The price money should not be included. The Supreme Court disregarded that as well, and it held that value of ticket cannot be abated with the value of price money. So therefore, the valuation rules in GST will have a more supreme power to levy tax. What was more important is that Supreme Court said that lotteries, betting, gambling are res extra commercium. It means these are not commercial activities. So there is the power of the Parliament to restrict such activities, and therefore taxation is valid. What this ruling is very important to provide, that it says that central and state has supreme power to levy taxes under GST and matters connected thereto. This ruling will have a larger challenge when constitutionality of provisions are challenged per se, wherein the Parliament has powers to levy GST on specific things or specific powers or not. But these are interesting areas in Supreme Court. Supreme Court has dealt very nicely to it, and we'll hope that the further rulings are to the helpful of SSC. With these, I'll conclude my session. We have covered some 5 important rulings under GST, and thank you everyone for bearing with up and to attend this session up. Thank you. Shubham, over to you now.